الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى من تبع هداهم إلى يوم الدين. الوجيز and it's the prayer chapter and what is permissible to do in the prayer. And inshallah we're trying to target ourselves to finish prayer so we go and talk about Ramadan, because Ramadan is coming inshallah. So we'll try to finish as much as we can today and the following week. And then after that, the other classes will be about Ramadan. Okay? Right, what is permissible to do in the prayer? What is the person permissible to do in the prayer which will not invalidate his prayer? The person is permissible to walk in the prayer if he needed to do so. For example, if a person is praying and somehow the door is locked and somebody wants to enter, then as long as you're facing the Qibla, so if the door is in the back, you could go in reverse, don't turn to the other side of the Qibla. If it's in the front, you go towards the door because you are towards the Qibla. If it's on the right, on the left, you just walk to the right, to the left. And as long as it is not really a long walk, and this is if it is a necessity, that means if the person can wait outside, there's no problem. But if it's a necessity, and the Prophet of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he used to open the door for Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, because it's only one door for her and only one access. And he would return back to where he's praying. So it's nothing to do with how many steps, but we could say reasonable. And then the person, when he look at the person, he knows that he's praying, he's not walking, he's not playing. So it's a movement that would not take the person outside. I think that there's an ant here being carried with me all the way from Reading. SubhanAllah, there it is. This is a Reading ant, couldn't kill it. Not Red as in Reading, but from a place called Reading. So she's now at the moment wandering. It's my homeland for her. Right, the second issue that which is permissible as well, to carry the child when you need to do so. Meaning the child is crying, carry him so that you can stop him from crying. But it's not you carry the child because you love the child. You can't leave the child and you can't really bear withstand having the child away from you. No, that's not that. Because if you want to do that, do it outside the prayer. In the prayer, if he's crying, if she is vulnerable, she might go somewhere else, the baby, you could carry that. Also, anything that would harm the person, he's allowed to kill it while he's in the prayer. So, he's being commanded to kill the two blacks. Two blacks here are the scorpion and the snake. Call it Al-Aswadan. Al-Aswadan is a word being mentioned to indicate number of issues. One, which is the two animals. And also, Al-Aswadan, in another hadith, the water and the dates called Al-Aswadan. So the daughter and the dates are called Aswadan. So we're not commanded to kill the dates and the water, but we're commanded to kill the what? The blacks, the stalks, the snakes, and the scorpion, regardless of their color. Aswad means black. But it doesn't mean that if I'm praying in the desert, I start killing the snake I could see, because I'm not going to be praying, I'm going to be hunting. So it is when I need to do so, that means it's attacking me while I'm praying. Also, it is allowed to give a gesture, which is in the prayer that you need to do so. So if the person is praying, somebody says salam, you could just make a movement with your hand, lifting up your palm in a way that the palm of yours is facing the earth, and the upper part side of your hand is facing the heavens. So you could say like that, salam, which is like that, simple like this, to indicate to the person that you're praying. If you are in the ruku' position, you may not stretch your hand, okay? You may just nod your head. Even in sujood, nod your head. But don't move your hands. Because the hands here move, holding the knee is one of the conditions in the prayer's pillars. And also in the sujood, you're not allowed to, well, to lift up all of those. But you nod your head. Just movement of the head to acknowledge that you are. Acknowledge the salutation, but at the same time you can't answer the person. Also, the person could give, for example, a hint to another person that, you know, if there is, for example, a persisting, very important call and you were waiting and the prayer is on, that call had called, what you need to do is just put the speaker on. You could do that while you're praying. don't worry, it's not really going to jeopardize the prayer. So I'm not going to, as well, I'm not going to be fined 6 points on the license like in the new law of the police. You open it and you make a sound of a word which is within the prayer, like Allahu Akbar, okay, to indicate to the person that you're praying. And that is, of course, for the Muslims, because the non-Muslims, if you say Allahu Akbar, they're going to put the phone down. This guy's going to be a terrorist or something. Allahu Akbar, oh my God! So, Allahu Akbar to a person who understands. And funnily enough, had happened with me that I was in a prayer and this person rang me. And it was not important because rang me my private number, so what I did, I thought I switched it off, but I actually I put it on. It was in my pocket, so I thought I switched it off, but actually I put it on. By, subhanAllah, unfortunately, I couldn't say this because everything were the plans of Allah, but I was in my tashahhud, and I was in the tahiyyat, and I was reaching the word, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad. So I raised my voice, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, so I raised my voice because I was, you know, how can the person phone me and he knows I'm an imam and praying here? So and then I realized the phone is on, so I put it off. You know, the guy who was on the other end is still alive. He thought I'm dying. So he told everybody, Sheikh's dying, he's saying his kalima. Because the way I said it in a low voice, and the person is still alive until today. I remember, and everybody was like, oh, he's dying. He said the last word of his, so he kept ringing after that. He kept ringing and I kept rejecting until I thought, what's that? We worried about you. I said, oh my, this person, what's he talking about? Once I was ringing the Sheikh Al-Albani, rahmatullah alayhi, and his wife, she was praying, I think, voluntary prayer. So I rang and rang and they were waiting for my phone call, and she had opened the speaker and she said, Allahu Akbar, I can't remember. Maybe Sami Allahu liman hamida, and then she put the phone down. Both, by the way, the husband and the wife died. I mean, the Sheikh Al-Albani and his wife, both of them, they died. Allah mercy upon them. Right, coming back. Also, it is allowed the person to spit if he needs to spit. Now, spitting, at the time of the Prophet of Allah, they spit in their garment itself. They lift it up, these are the first half, and then they spit in it, so they put the spittle. Now, Allah giving us the blessings. We got tissues, towel, which one was not available at the time of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, it is allowed for the person to make tasbih for the men. The men makes tasbih to the people or to the imam if he's made a mistake. His mistake is regarding going to the sujood instead of a ruku'. So he makes tasbih in order, or for example, he started a prayer which is supposed to be loud recitation, and he's now quiet for a bit of time, so you want to give him a push. Huh? SubhanAllah, to remind them that you are in a loud recitation prayer. So that is SubhanAllah. As for the women, they clap. Asfiq al-Nisa, clapping. Now the clapping of theirs, you read in some of the books, some of them they will clap on the thigh, which is not right. That clap is, regardless, we could just say, you could just, that's a clap. It is not like the women that will take their hands like this and just say, like that. It's like this. So that's the clap. And the clap, the reason behind this is number one, is because the woman usually is behind. So the sound, okay, is not going to reach. So this is for them, to the imam, that we have spotted a mistake. There's a mistake there. And that is number one. Number two, it is not to say that the woman's voice is awa. That's not right. All the wives of the Prophet of Allah, sallam, they used to answer the question for foreign men, men who are allowed to marry them, but of course they're not allowed to marry the wives of the Prophet of Allah, but still, it doesn't mean that they are our mothers, that we're allowed to see them without the hijab. They are our mothers and can't marry them after the Prophet's death. Okay, but it doesn't mean that we're allowed to see them without the hijab. So they used to speak to the people who are in need of answering the questions, no problem. So the voice of the woman is not our. But the woman, when she talks to the man, she needs to make sure that she's careful. So any hint in her voice that she's giving in or opening the door, that man will enter through that door. So the woman, she needs to know that, you know, it is a normal thing that she's like a sheep and he's a wolf. Basically, that it is. A wolf and a sheep. Once the woman opens a little door and the man sees it, he will enter through it. So the woman, she has to be that when, for example, we phone one of the brothers or some of the brothers of the shuyukh and their wives, they answer in a way which is formal, if you understand. Just as formal, so no hint of laughing and making a joke, because it starts with a joke and then ends up maybe with haram later on. So we have to make sure that, you know, it's just formal with a man. The women sometimes, and lots of them, and Allah described it in the Quran, al-ghafilat. وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ الْمُحْصِنَاتِ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ الْغَافِلَاتِ The ones who accuse the women who are غَافِلَاتِ غَافِلَاتِ means they're unaware. They don't know what is going around them. And that is why when a man came to the Prophet ﷺ, he said to the Messenger of Allah, my wife, لَا تَرُدُّ يَدَ لَامِسِ She does not stop people touching her hand. What happened is the men, for example, that somehow they want to give her something to her husband. So, you know, without her sort of realizing, they touch her hand. And her husband noticed that. Yet, imra'ati la taruddu yada lams. So the Prophet then said, talliq, divorce. He said, Messenger of Allah, I love her so much. I can't live without her. He said, well, then okay, then keep up with her. Then stay with her. So Prophet Allah, he didn't say that she's a badly mannered person. No, he said, talliq, if you don't like to stay with her, talliq. Maybe she's not suitable for you. You're a jealous man, very jealous. But she is unaware. Some of the sisters are unaware. So we have to understand that as a husband and a wife, usually, that husband wants the sister to go on something like this. Including myself and everybody wants his wife. You know. But the wife is not like this. She's like that. She is like that. She is made to be like that. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يَسْتَقِنَّ لَكُمْ عَلَى طَرِيقٍ For the husband, this is as well, they will not go on the path that they want them to go. So you want them to go something like this, they've got their own plans. They've got their own plans, they want to go like that. So you got. So every time you tell them something, they might do something else. So this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation to them. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, خُلِقْنَا مِنْ ضِلَعٍ ضِلَعٍ which is the rib. And the most crooked ضِلَعٍ ribbon your is the one at the top one. That's where she was created from. The short, and it is what? Crooked. Crooked like, you know, let's say that's crooked like this, you know, bent. Prophet said, if you want to straighten up, you'll break her. And breaking her means divorce. Okay? So you are like that. This is an example. You are like this, and she's like that. You're always, always, there'll be a gap. So if you try to straighten up to be like this, you're going to be what? Breaking it. You divorce her. So what is the way to make that this life going on? You be crooked as well. You go like that. You have to. If you don't look like this, it will not, there will be no life. So you have to keep a closed eye sometimes on those things. That is what the Prophet said. I don't find anybody could drive somebody who is prudent and sedate mad more than the woman. And a person who's calm, mashallah, nice. You want him to lose his temper? Send him a woman. Prophet Allah, he said this hadith like Muslim. مَا رَأَيْتُ أَذْهَبَ لِلُبِّ رَجُلٍ حَازِمٍ Lubb is the core of your brain, inside. Huh? The machine inside. Which is hazm is really straight and strict. More than the woman. She make him lose his temper. This is how we have to know that. And the way to live is to keep a close eye. And this is how it is. Coming back, also it is allowed for the person to correct the imam. So the imam, if he's now doing a recitation and he made a mistake in the Quran, they are allowed for those who are close by, not far away, to correct, even including the sisters. So if the sisters were close from the imam, they're allowed to correct with their own recitation. Now the correction is not like the one which is from ruku to sujood, or a person in a silent or loud recitation he was silent, or vice versa, he was in a silent recitation and he started reciting loud, okay? So the other one is just subhanallah, the person would say, the man or the woman would be clapping. But somebody made a mistake in his recitation, you don't do like this, I don't say subhanallah, you give him the what? The correction. Giving the correction to the imam is a fiqh in itself, actually. It's a fiqh. Because if the person who's behind the imam is not close by, he's far away, he should not. Number two, if he's not sure of what is corrected, he should not correct. Number three, if his correction is to the imam he believes is going to cause more of a mistake, you should be quiet here. Because you try to correct, not to create more problems. If you try to create more problems, but if you just die. So you're going to correct, and the imam will start stuttering and making a mistake with other verses. So you have to make, you have to be, that is why the person behind the imam, he has to be a person, not just hafil, he has to be, what we call him, sedate, maybe prudent person who knows what he's doing. Calm down. So it is not like to show that I am a hafil, that's why I corrected your mistake. Huh? And then some of the people, they make a correction, they terrorize you. Wallahi, they terrorize you. Like, wallahi, I once, one day I was reciting in a surah, which I know it by heart. But somehow, I made a mistake. This person behind me, I've never seen him before. He is behind me, he's mashallah. He was behind me in the Fajr prayer, boom! I forgot everything. I didn't know what is the recitation I was doing. So I said, Allahu Akbar. Rukua. I couldn't do anything. It scared me. After the prayer, I told my brother, this is not called Fatih. Fatih means to facilitate, to open for the imam. You have locked it up for me. I can't do it. I forgot. It's not this way. So when the person, for example, it's a mistake, listen, give you an example. Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ وَلَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This person made a mistake. هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. He said, هُدًى لِلْعَالِمِينَ. For example, he said, هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, هُدًى لِلْعَالِمِينَ. What is the correction way to that person? He said like this, المتقين. What's المتقين? I don't know where to put this word of yours. I don't know where to put the word. There is. As al-mutaqim, that's not right. Also, huda al-mutaqim, that's right. No. ذلك الكتاب, from the beginning of the verse. Don't even correct it. Say, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. So you give him the what? The verse from the beginning. Let him correct himself. So he would say, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه, huda للعالمين. He made a mistake again. So now in this case, this way I would say, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه, huda للمتقين. Because he did not correct himself at the beginning. That's the way it is. And the imam himself will help in this issue. How? If he is knowing himself, there is a mistake there, please don't speed up so that people cannot spot the mistake. So the imam, he knows. And number two, if he's made a mistake, he has to leave a gap. So if ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ اللَّهُ إِمَّا فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْعَالِمِينَ الَّذِينَ He's going back, straight forward. I can't any correction. He has to be what? Stopping a bit. So I have to wait for him to finish where there's a stop, and then I will return back to him for the verse slowly to make him sure that he's. But some of the imams, they will not let you correct it. And if he makes a mistake, ذلك الكتاب الله ربه في هدى للعالمين ذلك الكتاب الله ربه في هدى للقائلين look at the word. He's repeating himself, making the mistake, and he doesn't want to. And then after that, he doesn't want to correct it. Allahu Akbar. He doesn't want to, anyone to correct it. And it happened. And the imam should not do like this. Prophet of Allah made a mistake. And when he was not corrected, he said, Ghayr al-Ka'b, were you behind me? He said, yes, Messenger of Allah. Why? What prevented you from correcting me? Prophet of Allah is making a mistake. And who is the one who has given us the Quran as human being? Who's that? Prophet Muhammad. Prophet of Allah, he is immune from making mistakes once he receives it from the Jibreel salam and recites it to the companions to document it. There is no forgetting, because Jibreel is there to correct. But once, that is, the verse has been documented and the Prophet of Allah is reciting to lead the prayer, the human part kick in. Before it was divine part. Human part, the Prophet of Allah forgets. So even though that he is the one whom Allah Azza wa Jal, he had said, Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. Upon us, Allah said, for you to memorize it. You don't need, because the Prophet of Allah, when Jibreel as-Salam at the beginning came to him, Iqra, bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Prophet said, "Iqra' bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, iqra' bismi rabbika alladhi." He wants to memorize. Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him, "No, you don't have to do that. All you have to do what? Fattabi' Qur'an. Just to listen. That's all. Inna alayna jam'ahu wa tahfidhuh. We have upon us, we will gather it and also give it to you. So it is input inside you. So Allah Azza wa Jal, when He gives the Quran at the beginning to the Prophet of Allah, that's divine. It will not give a mistake. But later on, the Prophet of Allah is reciting something which is already revealed. This is a human part comes in and he forgets. So Ubay ibn Ka'b, why didn't you correct me? So you should have corrected me. Ubay ibn Ka'b did not correct the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right. Also from those things that is allowed in your brain, that is if somebody is in front of you and he's blocking your path to prayer, to prostrate, you could give him a nudge, even if he's asleep. And the Prophet of Allah, he used to pray in his room, and Aisha, she was lying down in front of him, and because the room is so small, Prophet of Allah doesn't have space for him to prostrate, he'll give a nudge to her feet, okay, and she will what? She move her feet for him to prostrate. So he will ghamazani. Whether he had touched, he touched her on the leg, in the skin to skin, or he touched her on the clothes, it doesn't matter, because touching the woman, it does not invalidate the prayer. It does not invalidate the woman. Also, it is allowed for you to make sure that there's nobody to come in front of between you and your sutra. The sutra, if you are an imam, you have to take a sutra. If you're not an imam, you are the person behind the imam, then the imam sutra is for you sutra. So nobody is to stop anybody to pass between the rows in the jama'ah prayer. It is the only way, the only thing that is not allowed is between the imam and his sutra. So the sutra could be the leg of the table, it could be the wall, it could be the back of another person. So you are allowed, if there's somebody to pass in front of you, to prevent him. And there's lots of way preventing, even if it is a child, even if it's an animal. You prevent that animal, but the prevention of somebody like a child or an animal, it will be different from preventing someone who understands. Preventing the animal, you're not going to put your hand like this because the animal doesn't understand that to stop. So you need to go forward. That is the walk which is permissible, we said, to walk forward to the sutra in order the animal would pass behind him. Like the Prophet of Allah, he made the sheep to pass behind him, not between him and the sutra, even the sheep. So the child, same thing, if he's going to be crawling, so the best thing is to go forward and let the child up, crawl behind him, not to make him pass in front of him. As for the person, is an adult or a person who understands, putting the hands, okay, should really stop him. If he doesn't want second time, put it there. Third time you could even push so hard into his chest, okay, that is to stop him. That is his chest, if it's a male to a male, female to a female, but not a male to a female. You can't prevent a woman by putting your hand on her chest to prevent her. Now, if it's a woman, the best thing is to go forward and make her what? Pass behind you. Because if she passed between you and the sutra, some of the scholars that will invalidate your prayer. Our Sheikh al-Albani does not. As long as you have sutra, your prayer is immune from invalidation. As long as you have sutra, regardless of somebody passing in front of you or not, you are immunized. It's the one who does not take sutra is the one who's having his prayer maybe jeopardized, because if she passes between him, the woman, and the sutra, which is his pot, which is his prostration spot, then his prayer or her prayer will be invalidated. The person is only to put his hand, nothing else. Or not allowed, for example, a person passing by to put his foot, you know, in front of him so the person, or on top of his face, and, you know, cause an injury, you know, with the hand so he could see. As for the buka, which is a crying, it is allowed to cry, which is a cry that is, you know, the person making a sound because he can't help it when he the Quran is being recited. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to pray and he used to cry as well himself, and that's called weeping. And also it is allowed, we add to the book, which is to make alhamd when you sneeze. So hamd, so that means the person that sneezes is allowed to say alhamdulillah. Not allowed for another person to say alhamdulillah when he's praying. Okay, but it's allowed to say because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he was leading the prayer, and there was the Prophet of Allah came, and the companions started to make a noise in order Abu Bakr could, you know, could see that the Prophet of Allah is there, so he should not be continuing leading the prayer. So Abu Bakr does not pay attention to anyone, even if the noise, because he's fully, wholeheartedly in the prayer, in the recitation. But when the noise was really a lot, he had to look. So when he looked on the side, he saw the Prophet was there. Straight away, he put the reverse gear and he went back. And the Prophet pointed to him, stay pot, stay as an imam. So Abu Bakr in that moment, he raised up his head, he raised up his hands and he started praising Allah Azza wa Jalla. Then he continued reversing back. Prophet ﷺ, he had to lead. So when he led, after the prayer, he said, Ya Abu Bakr, what prevented you from continuing to lead the prayer? He said, Messenger of Allah, it is not fit for the son of Allah to lead the people while the Prophet of Allah is amongst them. It is not fit for the son of Abu Qa'ada, not even to mention his name, Abu Bakr. I mean, I'm nothing. How can I lead somebody? How can I lead somebody? And the Prophet of Allah is with him. The Prophet of Allah is to lead. And using this point, I had somebody who had said something we have learned from him a lot, Jazakallahu Khairan. In Aylesbury, there's a masjid for the Brahmis. You know the Brahmis, they are Sufis, hardcore Sufis. We don't really say it is allowed for the person to go and pray behind a Brahmi, especially if it's a person who believes in the Brahmis in totality, then his prayer will be invalid behind him. So this person, he went to this masjid of the Brahmi and he didn't know he was a Brahmi. He went inside, then he prayed in a spot. And that spot, okay, pay attention, and that spot was allocated by that masjid to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So they believe the Prophet Allah come to that spot in what? In order to pray. So as soon as he come to the prayer, they told him off. How dare you pray in that spot? So when the Jama'ah was on, and now the people started praying. While they were praying, the Jama'ah, he went to pray in the same spot, deliberately. But they couldn't tell him off, because they prayed. So after the prayer, they wanted to beat him up. How dare you? And we told you not to pray to the Prophet of Allah's spot. He said, shame upon you guys. How you lead the prayer and the Prophet of Allah is behind you? He should be leading the prayer. I like that. I learned from him. How dare you? You couldn't really say anything. You lead the Prophet of Allah, you make him to lead. Imagine there's going to be nobody there, just a space. Who's leading you? The Prophet of Allah. Well, you can't say that. But they can't do that, kill them. Nobody will accept that. They can't hear properly. You know, what you have to do is actually to lower the sounds of the speakers here. And have you got a system? Did you reach that level?
No, not yet.
Okay. We have to do what we have to separate speakers. Separate speakers for the men. This is for Ramadan, inshallah. Speakers for the women. So they go through two channels. Do you understand me? So I have to swallow the microphone. I mean, okay, sisters. I mean, so they didn't hear the word?
No, they heard.
They heard, but they wanted louder. Okay, I think there's noise there as well. Yes. Okay, never mind. Remember, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Coming back, also, now we're going to talk about what invalidates the prayer. So what is permissible, what is invalidates the prayer? Invalidates the prayer, certainty of hadath. Hadath means you have done something, whether you passed wind, or urinated, or excreted unto yourself, or remembered that you were sleeping before you prayed, you did not make wudu, or you remember the wudu was invalid, okay, because you left your arm, whatever. So you have certainty, tayaqqun, 100%. Not to the maybe, maybe not, no, no, 100%. So the Prophet ﷺ, he told a remedy for the person who has got waswasa. Waswas, oh, if you've got a waswas, it's a problem. It might lead you not just to leave the prayer, to leave the whole of Islam. One day I was having some sort of takeaway in Southwood, and there was a person who don't know, mashallah, got a big beard. Looking at him straight away, I knew that there was something wrong with him. I knew it because I know the person's face. It's not because I'm a peer sad. No, but because, oh, you know, see lots of people like this. So you know the patience. And he sat down in front of me while I'm eating my food. So, you know, if you don't know somebody, you sit in front of somebody who's having food, it's not really right. But I knew that there's something wrong. So I said to him, brother, what's wrong with you? He said, I've got waswas. I said, I know already. The way that you are, I know. He said, it's killing me. I don't know what to do. I said, I don't have a magical wound. You know, find it like this. That's it. Abracadabra. It's you. You have to cure yourself. So I'm going to give you some of the ahadith of the Prophet. You learn from them. Otherwise, you're going to never. You know the waswasa? What is a waswasa? Person, he does something, and then after a while, he does not show. Is he doing it or not? So, for example, if he goes to the toilet, if he, for example, now he's using the lotta, you know, the bottle to pour water. If that water goes onto that water of the toilet, and there's a splash, he feels, or maybe it's real, that something splashed back onto him. So he starts cleaning that bit from his clothes that had the touch of that, he feels. So, subhanAllah. Then when he puts water again, that will go more and more. So he goes inside the toilet in order to have a wudu. He comes out having a shower. Whole of his clothes are wet. Because bit by bit, this is the bit, mommy, it's not really right, this is not really right. That is why they will go and make wudu with extreme cold water. Why extreme cold water? Because they want to make sure that every single spot on their skin where those lymph he has to wash is touched with the water. So he makes a freezing water and he makes wudu with it so that if somehow comes to his brain, I did not wash my, for example, head. I did not wipe my head. Like the water is freezing. Oh, no, my head is freezing. So I must have touched my head. That's how these people are. And they might as well start jumping inside the toilet. They jump and then they start making a sound like this just to make sure that they are on wudu. Some of them, they even, you know, when they try to clean their private parts, they injure themselves because they keep squeezing. Allah musta'an. So I feel pity for these people. So one day, Imam Ibn al-Jawzi, Sahib Kitab Talbis Iblis, Ibn al-Jawzi, rahmatullah, not Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi, Ibn al-Jawzi, the one who made a book about Talbis Iblis, about the waswas. Waswasa. A man came to him. He said to him, Imam, you know, I jump in the freezing pond, you know the pond, swimming pool, and I come out, and I want to know, is my wudu valid or not? It's not done with wudu now, it's more extra wudu plus. He made extra wudu plus. I jump out, you know, and I don't know if I'm wudu or not. Should I repeat the wudu? He said, no, you don't have to do the prayer. No, I'm asking about the wudu. No, there's no prayer upon you. Because the Prophet of Allah, he said, three people, the pen is raised from them, they're majnoon, until he becomes no majnoon. You are majnoon. There's no need for prayer. You're majnoon. You go into the pond and you jump in and you still, not wudu. Maybe there is something wrong with me. So you don't need to make wudu, you don't need to do the prayer. You're majnoon. So I told the brother that story just to make him, you are going to come to that stage where you are majnoon. So you have to make sure that, so the person, listen to the hadith. Prophet of Allah, he said, if you are in the prayer, don't come out of the prayer until you smell or you hear the sound. This is, for those who are waswasa. So if you've got a waswasa, you have to hear the bang or you have to smell that. Otherwise, don't come out of the prayer. But the person who's not having waswasa, if he's 100%, I made it. Because some of the people, they don't have a smell for that. Or maybe it's really a quiet one. But if you are 100%, you leave the prayer. But for those waswasa, okay. So not saying that, oh, the hadith says you have to hear it and you have to smell it, brother. But you could have a flu. You can't smell it. You could be deaf. No matter what happened, you're going to hear a sound, nothing. So it means that you are certain. If you are certain, you come out. If you are waswasa, don't come out until you hear it or you smell it. So that's a solution for you, my dear brother. And don't keep talking to yourself. You're going to end up losing the deen, leaving the whole religion and Islam because of that. You know how much he spends of his time to do that one prayer? 2 hours for each prayer. So he can't really pray, can he? Later on he's going to give up. It's too much for him. There's a person, he's making wudu. It took him about, I would say, 15 minutes. 15 minutes making wudu. The water's running. The whole tank is finished. I could see him. I feel pity for these people. And I feel a pity for the water bill, you know. So much! Allahu Musta'an. Because you want to make sure every single inch. Also from the things that would invalidate the prayer, that if you have left rukun, pillar, or shart condition, whether it is, he says here, amdan, deliberate. What is a rukun? Rukun, part of the prayer. Like you left rukua, you left sujood, you left takbirat al-ihram. What is a shart? Shart, like you left the wudu. Okay? So he says, without a valid excuse, without a valid excuse. The valid excuse here, that for example, you have flatulence. You have flatulence. That means, what is flatulence? An incontinence. Person cannot control the urine, and a person cannot control the what? The wind. So this person who cannot control his wind, we say to him, you make wudu at the beginning and the start of the time of the prayer. And you could do as many prayers as you want, as you wish, until the following time of the prayer. And then you stop. They have to make another wudu. Regardless how many wind you passed, regardless how much urine you have as well discharged, it doesn't make any difference. Because you're still in wudu, because if you have an excuse, you have a legitimate excuse. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's concession to the person. So look at that here. The person, a man, who had made wudu, and he was about to make the prayer, and he started making the prayer. Prophet of Allah, he spotted a dry spot into his feet, like the size of a coin, dirham. So the Prophet of Allah, he said to him, go and repeat the wudu and the salah. Repeat the wudu and the salah. Why did he ask him to do that? He could have asked him to just to wash his feet. What he did, he left a spot onto the area where he's supposed to wash, and that is rukun in the wudu, pillar in the wudu, to wash the feet. Also, the salah and al-salah condition from its acceptance to have what? A valid wudu. So if you had the rukun in the wudu is invalid, that means your wudu is invalid. And that is a prerequisite for the salah, that means your salah is invalid. But why did he tell him, the Prophet of Allah, to go and have a full wudu instead of having just to wash the feet? Anybody to tell me? Because we've said that before. Show me, come on. Yalla Habib, tell them. MashaAllah. See, the person writes, he will answer. It's because the sequence, close sequence, is a condition of the wudu. Remember? So this person, when he had made a wudu, and let's say that he left one of the foot, and then he went and he left, and the limbs had dried up, then he cannot just go and wash the feet. He has to start from what? From the beginning, because a close sequence. Has to be the washing the feet, the foot is within the time of that period. Meaning, if for example the person, if you remember I talked about person who is washing his, or making wudu in the kitchen, or let's say in the toilet upstairs, somehow the water in the toilet stopped, and it's just his foot is left. So he went downstairs to look for the tap which has got water. He found in the kitchen basin is already working. By the time he arrived, some of the limbs dried, it doesn't matter now. He could just wash the feet because he's linked. But he was searching for the water, so he's linked. It doesn't matter whether it's dried or not dried. But as long as you are within. But if the person, before he washed his foot, a call which is very important for him, came and he started talking to the person, and he forgot about washing the feet. Then he put the phone down, and then, oh, my wudu. He can't wash the feet now. He has to start from the beginning. Coming back, what does invalidate the prayer? Person eating and drinking deliberately. Deliberately means he doesn't know. Deliberately means he knows that he's eating. So if the person, for example, was in his prayer, somehow there was a hidden meat somewhere in his mouth, and suddenly it came out from his teeth or something, and he ate it, there's no problem, because it's not deliberate. But a person eating a sandwich, or having a drink, or sewing his clothes, you know, while he's praying, and he's not praying, he's playing. So that's not going to invalidate the prayer. Also, talking deliberately for not the maslaha of the prayer. It's not to do with the prayer. So subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, for the people who are making a mistake, that's no problem. But a person who is praying, and somebody is asking for his car keys, and his car has keys in his pocket. So he's praying, in my pocket. He's going to invalidate his prayer straight away. He can't say in my pocket, but he could point to his pocket. While he's praying, he's pointing. Remember the gesture is Allah, but talking is not Allah. الضحك. الضحك it invalidates the prayer, it does not invalidate the wudu. And I'm saying this because the Hanafi madhab says that the ضحك invalidates the what? The wudu. What is their proof? Qiyas, analogy. And that is why Ibn Hazm, who is the one who negates and does not believe in the qiyas, qiyas analogy, that he has used this as an example of how can these people who are naive to make qiyas. That is, they make qiyas that just like the ضحك, the laughter, would invalidate the prayer, it will invalidate the wudu. That's the Hanafi madhab. And that is why they said, oh, qiyas is, how can they make qiyas? This is a qiyas al haddadin ala al malaika. Qiyas haddadin, blacksmiths, with the angels. Is there any similarity between the blacksmiths and the angels? This is a similar qiyas between this and that. What is the qiyas? So, dhahik in the prayer, because you're not allowed to talk. And that is, but in the wudu, you could laugh, it doesn't matter, it doesn't invalidate the wudu. You have to have a proof for that. Finally, what invalidates your prayer? A woman who is adult, or a donkey, or a black dog passes between the person and his prostration spot. Because that not sutra, his what? Prostration spot. Because if you had a sutra, because this person is in Baptist Sheikh Albani's opinion, if you had a sutra, your prayer will be all the time, inshallah, okay. But if you have no sutra, and this individual, whether it's a donkey or black dog or a woman who's an adult, passes between you and your spot of prostration, your prayer will be invalid. Alhamdulillah, we finish now talking about the prayers in terms of what invalidates and what is permissible and what is disliked. We come now to the Salat al-Tatawwu', the prayer of what time is the Asr?
Quarter past five.
We'll finish inshallah before Asr, bidillah. Alhamdulillah, this is very good timing. So we'll finish about maybe 5 o'clock. Right. Salat al-Tatawwu', the prayer of the voluntary. The voluntary of the voluntary prayer is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jalla. Number one, why? Because it's a protection for your fault. Number two, there is no way for you, if you have missed an obligatory prayer, to compensate for that prayer because the time of it is gone. So if you miss Dhuhr, how are you going to compensate for Dhuhr? The Dhuhr is gone. You're not going to reverse the time unless you are Superman. Well, you would have. But you can't reverse the time. These people can reverse whatever they like, but we can't reverse the time. So what is the way to compensate for that prayer? To pray what? Voluntary. Prophet of Allah, he said, that Allah on the day of resurrection would say to his angels, that is, look into my prayers of my slave. If it's complete, then write it for him complete. If it's incomplete, look into his voluntary. And compensate for his missed obligatory. And it will be done not just in the prayer, in the siyam, the voluntary siyam, in the hajj voluntary, for example, hajj or voluntary umrah and all of that. Everything, if you have voluntary, that will compensate. So two benefits from the voluntary. Tatawwu', number one is that it's a protection. The person when he's lazy to pray is voluntary, alhamdulillah, he's got what is obligatory. But a person who's got no voluntary, and he becomes lazy, he's gonna bite into your obligatory. It's going to make you miss your obligatory. But you have voluntary, still there's a protection. Protection for that, but obligatory. So you might miss it sometime, and you might go back to it sometime. But if you have no voluntary, if you're going to get lazy, what are you going to do? You're going to start being lazy to do the obligatory itself. Now, the voluntary is supposed to be in the house, and that is where the recommendation is. So much that the Prophet of Allah SWT, he said, the prayer of a person in his house where people can't see him. And the Sahih, you can't see him, that means you could, if you have no house or what, you could pray in the masjid, but in a prayer area where people can't see you. Why? So there will be no riya. It's better than praying in the masjid, just like you pray your obligatory in the masjid of mine to pray it in another masjid. Now, what is the difference of praying your obligatory dhuhr prayer in this masjid and the difference of it between praying it in Masjid of the Prophet of Allah? How much? 1,000 times. 1,000 times multiple in the Masjid of the Haram. So you're going to get that 1,000 times if you pray your voluntary at home. So even in the Haram, if you are in Medina there, if you have your voluntary, your duha prayer, where you pray it in your hotel, better than praying it in the Masjid of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now the prayer of the voluntary is two types, which is general المطلقة and the other one which is مقيدة restricted. The restricted one is called سنن راتبة. سنة الظهر before الظهر, سنة before after الظهر, سنة before عصر, سنة after عصر, سنة before مغرب, سنة after مغرب, سنة before ظهر, called سنن what? راتبة. The other one which is the مطلقة is the نوافل. Those سنن الرواتب they are of two categories, emphasized and not emphasized. The emphasized, the callers have differed. How many rak'ah they are emphasized? Here, the Sheikh Al-Azim Badawi, Hafizahullah, he says that the emphasized are 12, 10. Some scholars, they say 12. He says, Hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, two rak'ah before dhuhr and two rak'ah after. And two rak'ah after Maghrib, two rak'ah after Isha, and two rak'ah before the Fajr. These are the 10 whom he says they are the emphasized. As I said, other scholars, they make it even more than that. They make it, there is the emphasized one, they make four before the dhuhr and four after the dhuhr. So these are the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ from, look at this Aisha, she says, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يدع أربعًا قبل الظهر. He does not leave up four before dhuhr. So if you put four before dhuhr and the rest of the hadith, it becomes now what? 12. If you make four before dhuhr and four after dhuhr, it becomes what? 14. Okay, so that is, so these are rawatib, emphasized, especially the fajr. Allah would never leave the fajr even if he's a traveler. All the other sunan will drop down. So if you're a traveler, you don't pray four before or four after. You're not supposed to. But the only one that you should pray all the time is sunnah al-fajr, prayer of the fajr. Prayer of the fajr and the prayer of the witr, they don't drop down even in the travel. If you are on a journey, you're supposed not to pray the dhuhr sunnah, and asr sunnah, and maghrib sunnah, and isha sunnah. You're not supposed to pray that. And that is Abdullah ibn Umar said, if I pray that, well, why should I then shorten the prayer? Let me make the dhuhr full. Dhuhr made for you two rak'ah, and you make it now two rak'ah and two, four before or four after. What's the point? Then make it four al khalas for dhuhr, complete. So don't do sunan ratiba for your travel. It's not from the sunnah to do it. It's against the sunnah. And only the fajr sunnah. He says here, it is also recommended to keep four before asr. And there is two rak'ah, which lots of people don't know, two after asr. As long as the sun does not go yellowish, it's two after asr. Prophet of Allah never leaves him. He never leaves him as well. Two after asr and before asr. And these two after asr are controversial. But we do have a hadith, regardless of controversial. Al-Witr, the prayer of the witr. The prayer of the witr is sunnah mu'akkada, emphasize sunnah. It is nothing to do with the Isha time. It is to do with the Isha prayer. Once you pray your Isha prayer, then you do your witr. It is not to wait until Isha time. So if you are a traveler and you prayed your Maghrib and Isha combined at the Maghrib time, you could start doing your witr before the Isha starts, the Isha time starts. So it is linked to the Isha prayer, it is not linked to the Isha time. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had emphasized it so much that even the Hanafi, they call it obligatory, but it's not obligatory. Hanaf, they say, witr prayer is what? Obligatory, but it's not obligatory. It is not correct to be obligatory. Now the time of the witr, as I said, is after Isha prayer, not after Isha time, until the Fajr dawn appearance. Not until the Fajr prayer, but the Fajr prayer could be after the Fajr time, so until the Fajr time. The better it is according to what you are sure of. So if you are a person sure of to wake up before Fajr, it's better for you to do like Umar al-Khattab just before Fajr. But if you are a person you know yourself you're going to sleep, then it's better for you to do it at the beginning of the night before you sleep. So that is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wa arda. Right, the witr, how many rak'ah and the description of it. How many rak'ah it is, without the two sunnah of the Isha, it is 11 rak'ah. With the two sunnah of the Isha, it becomes 13, two sunnah after the Isha. So it's 11 rak'ah. Those 11 rak'ah, you could pray them as follows. You could pray them 4 rak'ah, just like the 4 rak'ah of the dhuhr. 4 rak'ah and then 3. Or you could pray them 2, 2, 2, 2, 2 until you finish with 1, 11. Or you could pray them, that is 5 rak'ah, and that is with 1 tashahhud, the 5th one. And then 2, 2, and then 1. Sorry, 2, 2. So 5 rak'ah and then 2, 2. You could pray them as follows. You could pray them 7 rak'ah and then 2. How do you pray the 7 rak'ah? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the 6th you make the tashahhud. Stand up and make the 7th, another tashahhud, salutation, and then another 2. It's called 9. So that's 9 rak'ah. The Prophet of Allah used to pray them as well. Now the qunut in the witr is sometimes, most of the time we don't do qunut. So it's the other way around. But we find in Ramadan that if we count how many times the imam have done the qunut, it would be more than the times that he doesn't do the qunut. That's not right. The qunut is ahyan, sometimes. And if we count how many prayers of the Prophet of Allah he made, when he made qunut, how many times he made, we find none. It's only he taught it to Al-Hasan. Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, he said to him, when he said to Messenger, I'll teach you the dua to say the Qunut, he said to him, this following one. But we have documentation of the Prophet of Allah's prayer during the night, none of them mentioned the Prophet of Allah made Qunut. So the Qunut to be ahyan, sometimes. That's why the people make it wrong, they think all the time sunnah to make it the Qunut, it's not right. So he said to Al-Hasan, this is the following dua. اللهم اهدني فيمن هديت وعافني فيمن عافيت وتولني فيمن توليت وبارك لي فيما اعطيت وقني شر ما قضيت انك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك وانه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عليت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت لا منجى منك الا اليك. Sometimes you add صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدنا محمد. Not all the time. So اللهم اهدني فيمن هديت and don't add please. وعافني فيمن عافيت وتولني فيمن توليت وبارك لي فيما اعطيت. Some people وقني واصرف عني. There's no واصرف عني. شر ما قضيت. And there is فَإِنَّكَ تَقْضِي إِلَىٰ أَعْلِ بِالْحَقِّ. And there is no بِالْحَقِّ. إِنَّكَ تَقْضِي وَلَا يُقْضَىٰ عَلَيْكَ. Right, this is the witr. Now the place of that qunut of the witr is to be done before يَا إِخْوَانَ the wukur, not after. So it is before the wukur. The only time you do it after wukur, which is in Ramadan, after the 15th night of Ramadan, not even the beginning of it, where the person, he will add to the dua. It's not going to be now dua of qunut, it will be dua of nazila. Nazila means a crisis. Dua of nawazil, which is like, oh Lord, give victory to those people who are mujahideen, oh Lord, defeat the enemies of Allah, all of that. So that is, you could do it after the ruku. So companions used to do sometimes the qunut of the witr after the 15th night of Ramadan. After the ruku', but it's supposed to be most of the time before the ruku', ya ikhwan. And we find that the imams do it other way around. Most of it is after ruku', and sometimes they do it before ruku'. That's not right. So in the first 15 nights of Ramadan, the qunut is to be sometimes less than the time where you make qunut, less than the time where you don't make qunut, so you make less qunut, and also it has to be before the ruku'. And you say, Allahumma hadini fi man hadayt wa afini fi man afayt wa tawallani, up to the end of the hadith. Now the people behind him, the imam, they should say always ameen, regardless of what the person says. What the people they say, they say, Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, ameen, wa afina fi man afayt, ameen, wa tawallana fi man, ameen, wa qina sharra man qad, ameen, innaka taqdi wa la yaqda alayk, ashhad, subhanak. Probably say ashhad and subhanak. One person took his word and everybody thinks, he said, MashaAllah, he's the allama, scholar of his time. Start taking from him. Ya akhi, don't take your words except from knowledge. There's no subhanak, there's no ashhad. I don't know some of the people they say. Ashhadun subhanak and others. You should not supposed to say except for ameen and that's it. And that's the sunnah of the Prophet. As for the qunut in the fajr, that is to make it in the fajr all the time, that's a bid'ah. As the Shaykh says here, it's a bid'ah. And the qunut in the fajr, based upon a hadith which is not authentic, hadith of Anas, And the Prophet of Allah used to make the Qunut of the Fajr until he left the dunya, until he died. That's not right. It's unauthentic in its chain. I'm not going to go into the chain why it's not authentic. But simple enough, Anas himself in the Sahihah, Bukhari Muslim, the Prophet of Allah, he had made Qunut 1 month and he left. So how can Anas radiallahu anhu, documented with authentic chain in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, that the Prophet of Allah made Qunut for 1 month and left, and yet in the other hadith, which is not in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, okay, where he says that he kept making Qunut all his life until he died. So one of those to be correct. Simple, if you are not a person of knowledge in hadith, or is scientific, or is a science of hadith knowledge that you are special into it, simple for you. Bukhari Muslim takes priority over the other books. The Qunut in the Fajr, which the Prophet used to make sometimes for 1 month, that was because of a crisis. And the crisis is like time that he had sent some reciters called Sab'ina Qura, 70 reciters. And there was a tragedy. They were killed, all of them. They killed them, Bani Lihyan. Bani Lihyan killed all of them. And that is why the Prophet of Allah, he was so saddened. Companions had never seen him saddened on those reciters when they're killed. He saddened them for the doubt. They said to them, send us some da'iyah, you know, explain to us the Islam. When he sent those reciters, those people had betrayed. And we had Bi'r Ma'una and Satu Rajia. Both places we had the loss of very knowledgeable companions. So the Prophet of Allah, he started making dua against those people who were the killers. Now, there is no such thing that the crisis is to be an old one. So there's no one to make now dua, qunut, nawazil, for example. And it's to be in the Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha, and all of it. But the Prophet of Allah used to choose, most of the time, the prayer of the Maghrib and the prayer of the Fajr to make his qunut and nawazil. But it could be for any prayer. It is not to do with a crisis which is already finished a long time ago. So nobody is to make qunut now, oh Lord, get the Spanish people because they took Andalusia. He's about 800 years ago. That's what you're talking about. Andalusia. Andalusia is Andalus, you know, Spain. Oh Allah, return Spain back to us. That's not right. So it has to be fresh. Number two is to do with the fights and the crisis. It's nothing to do with istisqa. People ask me, for example, now we have a crisis in Africa. Can we make dua qunut nawazil? No. We have istisqa. They will make istisqa themselves. But till we ask, oh Lord, in the qunut nawazil? No, it is not. So the Qunut al-Nawazil is only for the crisis to do with the jihad and the jahideen and all of it. People are killers and people. We ask Allah to destroy them, more of it. Now, then he says Qiyam al-Layl. Qiyam al-Layl, which is that means you're praying that witr prayer in late night. Okay? It's the same thing which is, says here, minimum is 1 and the maximum is 11. Which is to do with the witr. People confuse it. They do witr, another qiyam, and another tahajjud. They end up praying, I don't know how many rak'ahs. So it's all of it, qiyam, and the witr, and the taraweeh, and the tahajjud, and salat al-layl. 5 names for it still talk about the same thing. And it's talking about now in Ramadan. So that one before witr on your own, this one is to do with what? Jama'ah. Qiyam with what? In jama'ah. In jama'ah, the only prayer which is voluntary that you do in jama'ah is the qiyam. And the qiyam, which is in Ramadan, the sisters are not excluded from that qiyam like they are, for example, in the normal prayer of Dhuhr and Asr. So in the Dhuhr and Asr, the sisters, preferably for them to pray at home. But for the qiyam in Ramadan, they can't get it at home. They only get it what? In the masjid. Just like they come for learning knowledge, they have to come to learn the knowledge, and this husband should not prevent them from that. Also should not prevent them if they want to come to the Qiyam prayer as long as they are dressed up properly. Okay. Person who's making Qiyam is supposed to keep up with that Qiyam. Should not really leave it. It's this light. And now we come into one of those voluntary prayers called Salat al-Duha. Duha is the prayer that is after sunrise by some time, about 10 to 12 minutes, 15 minutes minimum, I could say, better, until 15 minutes before Dhuhr time. That's called Salat al-Duha. The later it is, the better it is. I mean, the more you push it towards the Dhuhr, it's better than praying it at the beginning of its time. This duha, we don't have any number how many rak'ah it is. Scholars have different. Some of them they said 4, some of them they said 8, some of them they said 12. But the correct opinion that there is no okay number for them. So you can pray them regardless of how many rak'ah. The Prophet wasallam, he said, each limb of yours, each joint of yours in your body has to produce a sadaqah. So every tasbiha is a sadaqah. Every tahmeed, alhamdulillah, sadaqah. Every tahleel, la ilaha illallah, is a sadaqah. Every takbir, Allahu Akbar, is a sadaqah. Enjoining good and forbidding evil is a sadaqah, sadaqah. And if you do the 2 rak'ah of the duha, would suffice you from all of that. SubhanAllah. The best of time, as I said, is just towards the duha, but just you have to finish 15 minutes before the time. If you go to a Hanafi masjid or those masajid which is the Hanafis, you will find that the clock will start flashing before the Dhuhr. That means, well, don't pray, don't pray, don't pray. Which is correct. You're not supposed to pray that time. You're not supposed to pray what? Your voluntary prayer. But if you came to pray Tahiyyat al-Masjid, Tahiyyat al-Masjid is a must upon the person to pray before he sits down. Okay? Also from the sunnah, which is the voluntary, is to pray to sunnah after the wudu. The 2 rak'ah of the sunnah that Bilal radiallahu anhu was special to his. And Prophet of Allah, he had heard him in paradise when he entered one night in his region, entered paradise, he had heard the steps of Bilal, and he asked him why you were there before me. He said, by the Messenger of Allah, every time I make wudu, I make 2 rak'ah. Bilal has got the specialty of the following 2. Number 1, every time he makes a hadith, he validates his wudu, he makes wudu. And every time he makes wudu, he prays what? 2 rak'ah. So again, every time he invalidates his wudu, he makes wudu. And every time he makes wudu, he makes what? 2 rak'ah. Salatul istikhara. Salatul istikhara is the last thing we could handle here. Al istikhara is making a choice in something that you don't know which is better for you. So every person who's about to do something which is, you know, not from those things which is, you know, the actual, you know, that you need to do it. So for example, you don't just do istikhara, shall I do my Dhuhr prayer or not? I make istikhara first. No, you have to do the Dhuhr prayer. Can't make istikhara with Dhuhr or not. So it's, okay, for example, I'm going to eat food. No, I make istikhara, shall I eat food or not? No, you have to eat food, because you're dying without food. Okay? Or can I want to make hajj, shall I make istikhara? Shall I make hajj or not? Hajj is compulsory, unless the hajj is voluntary. Hajj is voluntary, you're making istikhara. Is it better for me not to make the hajj and to stay looking after my family, or to do the hajj which is voluntary? That's no problem, you make istikhara. That's something which you must do, you can't make istikhara. So when the Prophet of Allah said, when about one of you is about to do something, then let him do 2 rak'ah. It is something that that you normally don't do. Number 2, it is something that you don't know the outcome of it. But you don't do 2 istikhara, for example. Shall I, I'm gonna go to the toilet. I'm gonna make istikhara. Shall I go to the toilet or not? Simple people, I mean, you laugh at this, but some people, they do things like, it's as simple as that. Shall I go to work or not? Make istikhara. You have to go to work, yeah. You have to work. But which work it is? Is this good work or not? That's istikhara. But to work, you have to work to provide your family. Can't do istikhara on that. The dua of the Prophet ﷺ that he taught us to say is, when you do 2 rak'ah, you finish the 2 rak'ah, these 2 rak'ah is better to be designated for istikhara. But if you had made it, like for example, the 2 rak'ah of the duha, or the 2 rak'ah of the sunnah of dhuhr, as long as it's not obligatory, then you could use that as well as istikhara. After the prayer, you say, Allahumma inni astakhiruka bi ilmik, wa astakhiruka bi qudratik, wa asaluka bi fadlika al-azim. فإنك تقدر ولا أقدر وتعلم ولا أعلم وأنت علام الغيوب اللهم إن كنت تعلم أن هذا الأمر خير لي في ديني ومعاشي وعقبة أمري أو في عاجل أمري وآجله فاقدره لي وإن كنت تعلم أن هذا الأمر شر لي في ديني ومعاشي وعقبة أمري فاصرفه عني واصرفني عنه واخذه بيد الخير حيث كان ثم ارضني أو ارضني به. Then you call upon what you need to ask Allah for. So like for example, buying a car, or buying a house, or marrying a woman, or marrying a husband, or whatever, all of that istikhara is important. Salat al-Kusuf, prayer of the Kusuf, is inshallah in 2 weeks' time. And I think, I will believe that if I step on it, let me finish the Kusuf, please. Al-Kusuf. Al-Kusuf is the eclipse prayer. Eclipse, whether it's for the sun or for the moon. When the person knows about an eclipse, then the person should rush to the prayer. But people now rush to the telescopes and binoculars, and God knows what they're rushing to. And they start, you know, looking at this. No. As soon as you find this, this is to show the power of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Whether it's partial eclipse or total eclipse, whether the sun is blocked completely or partially. The moon eclipse is the other way around. Sun eclipse is that the earth comes in between the sun, sorry, the moon comes between the sun and the earth. That's the eclipse of the sun. So the moon comes between the earth and the sun during the day. And as for the eclipse of the moon, which is that we find that the earth comes between the sun and the moon. So the moon will be like a big disk, but it's got no light in it. Why? Because the earth is blocking that light. SubhanAllah. So usually it is the case that the Prophet of Allah, he prayed the eclipse of the sun, because the eclipse of the moon, you know, normally people are asleep, they're not awake. But if you had eclipse of the moon, which we prayed one night in Jordan, I remember, we had to stay a bit an hour late, and we prayed alhamdulillah in the masjid. The prayer of the eclipse is in the masajid or the musallayat outside. You pray, and then after the prayer there is a khutbah. This prayer is a special one. It has two ruku' in each rak'ah. So it's two rak'ah. Each rak'ah has got two ruku' and of course two sajda. Another rak'ah has got two ruku' and two sajda. So it makes it four ruku', four sujood in the whole of the prayer. The etiquette of praying the prayer is to cite the Fatiha, then after that a long surah, then after that rukur, then sami Allah liman hamidah, then after that you start again Fatiha and another surah, or you continue that surah if you wish, and then after that Allahu Akbar, then sami Allah liman hamidah, rabbana wa lakal hamd, then go to the sujood, continue normal prayer, second rak'ah, same thing. So you read the Fatiha how many times in two rak'ah? How many times you do the Fatiha? Please, forgive me, I'm asking you, but it looks like you're sleeping. Four times. First, say Fatiha, then Surah, then Allahu Akbar, Rukur, long Rukur, then Sami Allah liman hamid, Fatiha again. Continue the Surah or another Surah. Then Allahu Akbar. Then the Rukur, then Sami Allah liman hamida, and then you continue the two sajda. Same thing with the second rakah. Okay? So that is called the prayer of the Kusuf. Now the prayer of the Kusuf is to be said loud. After that there is a khutbah. People recommended for them to stay for the khutbah. Salatul Istisqa. Istisqa prayer is the prayer of the rain. This prayer of the rain is of three types. One is to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second one during the Jummah. The Prophet of Allah made Istisqa by making dua on the pulpit when the Bedouin man came to a messenger of Allah who are about to die, his sheep are about to die, there's no rain, call upon Allah to send us the rain. As soon as he called upon Allah, the rain started to pour down until the following week, following in the khutbah al-Jum'ah, same man or different man came, messenger of Allah, we're drowning from the water. Called upon Allah to remove that cloud. So the Prophet of Allah, he called upon Allah to remove the cloud, and the cloud was removed. So, but he said, O Lord, hawalayna wa la'ali, make the rain upon the ones who are around us. Don't stop the rain, O Lord, make it a community because the rain is good. But for us, it's too much now. On the people who are aside, like on the mountains, and on the Akam, as the Prophet of Allah said. Okay, so by this, alhamdulillah, I think I've given you a heavy dose. I don't want to give you a headache. So let's just give you some questions and answers for the next 10 days, inshallah. Don't give the adhan until I leave. JazakAllah. They don't see that. You could see me for the question as well? Which camera? This one?
That one, yeah.
Question about the beard. Nothing to do with our class. Okay, another question? Before we go to the question of the beard. Now. If the Masjid al-Haram or the Masjid al-Haram of Mecca or Medina, you're not supposed to let people pass between you. So when you pray, if you're praying behind the Imam, there's no stoppage upon you. Because we said there's no sutra. The Imam Sutra, so you let the people pass between the rows. So if you pray in front of you, please don't pray in the middle of the path, don't pray in the exits and the entrance and all of that. Pray next to a pool or next to a corner, pray. And minimize. So if you can't really stop these people, just go forward and let them pass behind you. But some people, they come in the middle of the path where the people rotate and start praying. Like the Maqam Ibrahim, bunch of people really protecting that man. He's going to pray next to the Maqam of Ibrahim. And the gestures he made, lots of people fall down. That's not right. So you call him to a corner. Masjid al-Haram is big, mashallah, huge man. Lots of corners. You could just choose a corner and pray as much as you want. You have to pray relaxing. You don't want to be praying with wrestling. Start doing like this and like this and like this and stopping and jumping. You shouldn't do that. So you're praying with relaxing. So you go to a place where minimum passage of the people. Now. There's no question. The beard, correct, is to leave it as much as the fist. To leave it as much as the fist. I think I showed you the beard, didn't I, before? No. To leave it up to the fist. That's the fist. Okay, so you leave it up there, and then whatever goes from there, you cut. But to shorten it shorter than that, it's not from the sunnah. Now, to make it longer than that, that's the argument taking place between some of the scholars and the scholars of Islam. Now, if I give you this, you know what the beard is not supposed to be like that. The beard could be a hazard. You sleep and strangle yourself with it. Okay, if it's really too much. So let's just talk about this beard, which we captured in the Haram. Okay. Look at that. Right, look at this beard. Look at that. That's almost to the floor. Come on, this is a tahir. I mean, it looks weird, doesn't it? But those who said let go of the beard, I mean, that's not right. If I was there, I would say, La hawla wa la quwwata. That's a hazard, you know? I'm sure that he puts it in a carrier bag when he sleeps. He must have something to it, because my wife, if his wife next to him, she might step on him, and he will, you know, be a fight during the night. So that is it. But when you see this beard now, when I told you that this one is about maybe a meter and a half, 2 meters long. Meter and a half. But the longest beard is the beard of Hans Lunch. Now you could just go and Google it. Hans Lunch in the Guinness Book, 5.3 meters. Almost to the chair there. This is beard. 5.3 in Guinness Book. Hans Lunch, he's a German guy. Subhanallah. I mean, what is he going to do with that beard? I use it for washing the plates with it or something. What is this beard? I mean, Allah understand. Now, tafadhol.
This is a question regarding the compensation of the sunnah to the obligatory. So if you know that one prayer from like a few days ago, you know it's not valid because of a mistake. If the prayer is dhuhr, for instance.
It's for the prayer, it's one dhuhr?
If it's a dhuhr prayer.
It's a dhuhr.
Does it mean that four rak'ah of the sunnah is going to compensate four rak'ah of the dhuhr, or there is no quantification for it?
If a person missed the prayer, did not remember it at all.
It's not valid for some reason.
But he has to do it.
Yes.
He has to do it. So for example, you remember the prayer, he has got no wudu over it. He would repeat that prayer. Okay, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a person who did not pray because he was no good person. Okay? He wasn't a good person. So he left the prayer deliberately. As for the person, he forgot something in the prayer or forgot to do the prayer, then he remembers it. He prays it once he remembers it. That is a compensation for that. But they say that a person, he comes to a days where, you know, he's a'udhu billah, he leaves the prayer, abandons it. Let's say a person, he'd been praying and then stopped for 2, 3, 4 years. And he comes back to the prayer. We don't say to the brother, take your cut later. 5 daily prayers for every day, that's a month. Oh, that's 150 a month, 12 months, that's 1,000. 750, he said, forget about it. I'm going to pray 1,500 before I start repenting. It's too much. All these people, they make it to, for example, do the Asr twice, do the Dhuhr twice. One person sleep 3 times. After you pray the Dhuhr, pray the Dhuhr again and Dhuhr again. Why? They told me because they have to, you know, calculate how much prayers I have left. Because I came to pray when I was 21. So I was becoming an adult from 15 to 21. That's 6 years. So 6 years each one is 6,000 rak'ah, 36,000 rak'ah I had to do before, you know. That's what they tell him. One person who wants to repent hears these big numbers, 36,000 rak'ah, he's forgetting about the prayer. He's not going to pray, so that is not right. We say to him, no, 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 you start from the beginning fresh. What voluntary prayer is there? Voluntary prayer is there. And on top of the voluntary prayer, there is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah. Now, sisters, have any questions? Nobody knows up?
Just a rewind of...
A rewind? Yeah. You're going to rewind, okay. What do you want for you?
Cover this, but to make it clear for some of us. You know, if you could give us a practical example of how to join where the man is in the rukuh position.
So the person, he is in the rukuh. The imam is in the rukuh, and the people... and the people who are praying, okay. I think the question was to ask me from who asked me the question here. Because the masjid would be very good for that question. Let's say that your door is from the back, okay? And the imam is in the rukuh, enters from the door there, person would make Allahu Akbar to the haram, fully standing up, and Allahu Akbar for rukuh, and he will start walking while he's making rukuh. Okay? Until he joins the rukuh. That's the correct opinion. But now, talking about if he comes from this way, he cannot make the Qibla haram facing that direction. Do you understand me? He cannot. He has to make it while he's facing this direction. Okay? The only way to do it, if he wants, is to make the Qibla haram start reversing and join the rukuh. If he had put himself into the rukuh and joined his feet with his hand before the imam said, Sami Allah liman hamida, he has caught up with the rak'ah even though he was not in the row yet. Okay? But it has to be within a reasonable distance, like here. But if you are, for example, in a masjid, like Regent Park Mosque, and you have the first two rows there, and they are on the rukuh, and you enter from the door, that's a mile walk. You could be making prostration, that's like a rak'ah, and still you haven't reached. It has to be within what? Reasonable distance. In the haram, you finish the prayer, you haven't reached. You go to the front rows. Do you understand that? So the person who comes to the masjid, when the imam is on the rukuh, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he said in front of the companions in the khutbah al Jum'ah, he said, Inna mina sunnah, from the sunnah is to make a bit of haram, then you do barak, yani. He makes rukuh and he walks while he's making the rukuh. Right?
Okay?
There is no crossing of the arms because there is no standing up position. So Allahu Akbar, down. And Allahu Akbar for the second for the rukuh and you go down. There is no Allahu Akbar. Like the people when they find the imam in the sujood, say Allahu Akbar. This is for qira'ah, there's no qira'ah here. So say Allahu Akbar, take the haram. And Allahu Akbar again for the rukuh and keep walking until you join the row. This is the opinion of Abu Bakr, Zayd ibn Thabit, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and Abdullah ibn Zubayr. From them, we don't have any people to oppose them. So that's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's a controversial issue. Okay, سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك الله وخير بارك الله. Person had caught up with the imam in his upright position, and he's reciting loud. You don't do anything. But if he's reciting silently, you do the Fatiha. You could not catch up with the Fatiha, you had to worry about it. As long as you catch up with the imam before he says سميع الله لمن حمده, you caught up with the rak'ah, regardless if you recited the Fatiha or not. As soon as you come in, and you don't know when the imam started, and he's in the silent recitation, don't start with, for example, the opening ceremony, opening supplication. Don't do that. Start with the what? Fatiha straight away. And do as much as you can from the Fatiha. And don't recite like this, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. And the imam's finished. Recite it properly and swiftly. If there are any evidence for saying Allahumma, Journey Minar after. These sisters, can you write properly? Because I can't read you.
Is there any evidence for saying Allahumma ajirni minan nar after?
Is your wife, is
he? Allahumma ajirni minan nar after Fajr and Maghrib seven times. After Fajr.
Okay, Very good question. So after Maghrib and after Fajr, there is a hadith which is authentic. That is, O Lord, I ask refuge from you from the fire 7 times, and also I ask, O Lord, from you 7 times Jannah. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannah, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannah, Allahumma inni as'aluka 7 times. Allahumma ajurni minan nar, Allahumma ajurni minan nar, 7 times from the, after the Maghrib and after the Fajr. Jazakallah khairan.